talent can help startups grow. And we have with us Shreya Prakash. She is the CEO and co-founder of FlexiBiz. FlexiBiz is an organization with a vision to re-employ qualified and experienced women professionals across all areas of expertise for whom part-time work from home works better as a life choice. She is very passionate about the space, about this space actually, and Shreya has written and continues to write cutting-edge and popular articles on this subject. So with this, I would like to call Shreya and, you know, she can take forward for this session.
Sure. Thanks, Shabnam. And thank you, Pai, for giving me this platform. So, yeah, very happy to be talking to you guys all today. I think Shabnam has given an introduction. So we provide as FlexiBiz flexible talent, which is part-time, project-based, remote working talent to businesses, and via women professionals who want to return to work or want to work flexibly by choice.
Record karo.
And we've been around for 3 years now. It's been a great journey, and we work with a lot of startups, and we are a startup ourselves. So we are passionate about the way flexibility can unlock a very lean, hiring model for startups, a very lean and agile hiring model for startups, which is the need of the hour right now, but even otherwise is extremely beneficial to growing businesses. So I will talk a little bit about that and also give few examples and case studies from some of the work that we've done so that it becomes, it becomes more real for all of you guys who are listening. So I think I'm going to start with a presentation, which is short, and a lot of it is case studies and examples. So hopefully it should be interesting. And then after that, we'll do an introduction. Let me just share my screen. Yeah. Okay. So I think you guys should be now seeing my screen. So yeah, how can flexible talent help startups grow? So I'm going to first talk a little bit about the constraints that startups face in hiring. And it would be great to know from you guys also when we do our interaction, what are the constraints that you have. But from our experience as a startup and from our work with startups, these are some of the things that we've seen. So first of all, tight budgets and cash flows. Who can argue with that? Startups do need experienced talent to grow, but full-time talent can be expensive. So what a lot of startups end up doing is they end up hiring interns and freshers, which is great if you have the time to invest in the talent before they start being productive. But a lot of the time, startups don't have these luxuries. They need their talent to be productive from day one, which requires expertise, but expertise is expensive. So that definitely is a constraint that startups face in being able to grow quickly. The other big constraint area is that demand takes a while to ramp up. So a lot of us who work with startups or are leading startups would know this, that even if you have a cracker of an idea, it takes perhaps some time for you to build enough business such that it allows you to build out a team. For example, you could be, say, an investment banking startup. And I'm using this example because it's a live example that we've seen. You could be an investment banking startup who, is seeing a lot of interest, is seeing some business as well, but not enough for you to hire, say, a back-end team who can do the, activities such as research and modeling or creating pitch decks while you handle the front-end selling to the client. So what you end up doing or what you may end up doing is either paying from your own pocket to have that team in place, or you end up doing a lot of it yourself and stretching yourself. None of these two things are optimum, and they both put a barrier to how quickly you can grow. So that is, a second constraint area that we identified. And then, of course, the need for MVPs and pivots. Now, startups by design need to be able to move quickly, do a lot of experimentation, go into new geographies, go into new go and launch new product lines, service lines, and see how it goes. Be ready to pivot. And a lot of these require a very agile environment, a very experimentation-oriented environment for across different functions, but also for hiring, where you need to maybe hire quickly, you need to be able to scale up and scale down quickly, and conventional talent hiring models don't allow for this. So these are a few of the constraints that we've identified that startups face in hiring, which we ourselves, of course, also faced. And while I say startups over here, even larger businesses today are facing some of these because, gone are the days when any company, however large it may be, had the luxury of, say, 2-year-long innovation cycles. I mean, today, the market conditions are so dynamic and so competitive that even larger companies need to be really innovative. They need to have, high speed to market. Be very entrepreneurial in certain parts of their business. And that all requires agility. And it requires being able to scale with budget constraints many times. So yeah, I mean, across businesses today, these are some of the constraints they face, which of course have got compounded because of the COVID-19 situation. Cash flows have become tighter. Even for those of us who have demand and who are doing business, the cash situation is not improving. Payments are coming in very late and they are delayed because our clients are facing problems at their end. So the cash flow situation has not improved in many cases. Demand is even more uncertain. And again, for those of us who have the business or business has started showing green shoots, we don't know by when it will go back to the original level or beyond. So that's even more uncertain of business environment to be in. And in stark contrast to these two, the third space is of an opportunity where today we do definitely all businesses, whether startups or larger businesses, need to reflect and adapt our models and our product and service lines to new realities. So one thing that the pandemic has brought, which we are all aware of, is that as consumers, a lot of our habits have changed. A lot of our purchase priorities have changed. Our means of purchasing, delivery models, media consumption, a lot of those things have changed. And businesses are looking inwards and figuring out how to quickly adapt to these new realities. And many actually have already done it. People have been piloting and pivoting since one week into the lockdowns, which is the hallmark of, say, a truly agile business or a truly agile startup. But that requires being able to really galvanize teams quickly, being able to be agile, do MVPs and pivots. Again, a lot of it critically today needs agile hiring and talent models. So this is the constraint environment, so to say, or the context the backdrop against which flexible talent can play a role. Now, coming to the answer to some of these constraints and how, and one of those answers is flexible talent. And coming to how flexible talent can help businesses navigate these problems. So first of all, I'll talk a little bit about the Flexi Talent ecosystem and what it is. What are the different pillars and aspects of the Flexi Talent ecosystem to familiarize you with it? So first of all, what is the Flexi Talent ecosystem, or what kind of skills can you get within that ecosystem? So a lot of us may think or may believe today that the skills that you can get, in a flexible manner are a limited set of skills, like, say, content or graphic or even coding. But today, the Flexi Talent has expanded and evolved to include skills of every variety and function. So a whole bunch of professionals from across different functions and different areas have entered the Flexi Talent ecosystem today, and for different reasons. It could be qualified professionals, women professionals who want to work, in part-time and remote, do not want to be a part of the traditional, workforce. Or it could be because, freelancers by choice want to have more variety in their lives, want to keep themselves updated on, new age skills and want to work across companies and, across different kinds of industries. So it could be a variety of reasons because of which this has happened. But what has happened is that the flexi talent economy today is booming. There is a lot of influx of good talent here. So today you can find skills across the spectrum. You can find everything from, say, very core and operational functions like sales or marketing, investment banking, and you can definitely find your content, design, your technology. So it basically any skill that you can think of and which you may need for your organization, chances are you can find a flexible worker, a flexible talent for it. And what these people bring to the table is they are experts, they are experienced. So they bring exact skill sets. Many of them bring new age skill sets because they've been working across different kinds of technologies and industries. For a flexi worker, their currency is skill. So they are very particular about updating them many, many times. So you get new age skills where training required is minimal. And as a startup, that really works because you get talent that is productive from day one. The second aspect is how can the engagements be structured. So again, a lot of choice here. The engagements can be structured either as, say, a two-week project, as short as that, or it could be a two-year long running, role. And the how it is different, say, from hiring an employee who works with you is that most of them are contractual. They are contract talent. And there is always some or the other form of flexibility in the arrangement, whether part-time and or remote work. Now, connected to that is how the pricing models look. So the pricing models are, if you're hiring somebody part-time, then you could be hiring them for, say, 75% of their workday, or 50% or 25% of their workday. And you would be paying exactly as for that. You would be paying, say, half the price if you were hiring 100% of their workday. Similarly, if your engagement is in a project way, you could price it as per the number of hours that have been consumed for the project. Or if your scope is really tight, then you could structure it as per the milestones. Or you could do it in a very performance-oriented way as per output. And all of these ways of structuring are actually very cost-effective because they are all paid for time needed. You know exactly how much time you need, and you're paying for that. And lastly, a very important aspect of the flexi talent ecosystem is the agility. That it, much as it's important to hire quickly, it is important to be able to let go quickly as well. So quick scale up, but also quick scale down in case the external environment changes, which can happen for a startup. We all operate in dynamic environments. Funding could dry up, some other thing could happen, competition could come, or an unprecedented situation such as COVID, where which nobody could have foreseen, and which during which a lot of companies faced a tough time. So startups need to have some percentage or component of their talent such that they can draw back into a lean team very quickly. So flexible hiring allows you to do that. So these are the four essential pillars of the flexible talent ecosystem, and they answer in one way or the other the constraints that I spoke about earlier. You can get really good quality talent, but cost effectively, because you're paying only part-time, you're paying in a project way, you're paying for the skills and the talent and the time that you need. And you can very quickly hire them. You can also make sure that your team stays lean in case the environment around you changes. So some of these are how those constraints can be tackled. And to make this more real, like I said at the beginning, and to make it more easier to understand, I have a bunch of examples that I want to talk about. I picked some which I felt were good examples and give you guys a good idea. So we'll just go into the examples now. Yeah. So I've picked examples from across different functions. So this is an example of sales that we did. And it was a bootstrapped startup in the cloud solution space, and they needed a pre-sales professional to work for 2 to 3 hours a day and to do the typical pre-sales activities, set up a appointments with clients, understand requirements, make proposals, do follow-ups, help prepare any technical documentation, etc. What we were able to give them was a candidate with very good experience in pre-sales and IT, and who had done very similar kind of activities in her previous role. And this worked out very well for them. This was, in fact, couple of years ago. And since then, the startup has really grown. This person, in fact, went in for 2 to 3 hours at the beginning, but then her hours also increased. It went up from 2 to 3 hours to 4 to 5 hours as they saw that the talent was good and as their own business kept increasing. So, yeah, this was a good example of how you can use, somebody in sales flexibly. And a marketing example. So this was again a very, very early stage startup in the B2B e-commerce space. They had a platform where they had content, they had interactions, and eventually they wanted to move to transactions. And they wanted to set up their marketing to get somebody who could do their positioning, branding, but also execution of offline and online activities to get more traffic and more engagement on their website. So they hired somebody to work for 20 to 25 hours a week doing all of these activities. The person that we gave them actually had a lot of these skills, had the B2B experience, had the B2B experience in marketing, and was able to do a lot of these things, like be it strategies, do the communication offline and online, a lot of which is difficult to get in the same person, but we were able to find this person for them. And the 20 to 25 hours a week, that is half the time, worked well because they were so early in their journey. Another marketing example, and this one is more of a project, while the previous one was more role. So here, a global FMCG, they wanted, they were entering India within the personal care space, and they wanted somebody who could design their launch strategy and execute it, or at least work on the execution plan as well. And their requirement was quite flexible. The range of hours that they wanted was between 20 to 40 per month, and the billing would happen at the end as per the number of hours that were actually incurred. And again, this was a difficult fit, because it needed somebody who had beauty marketing experience in digital as well as offline. But we were able to find the right person who, and the beauty of all of this is actually, pun not intended, is that the talent gets as much out of it as the companies get. So for example, in this case, the talent herself, she was pregnant at the time that she was working on this project, and she wanted to not work in a full-time role because she wanted a little time off. But this project fit very well in the life stage in which she was in at that time. The 20 to 40 hours a month was extremely doable, and it worked very well for her as well as much as it did for the client. So much so that after this project got over, the client came back to us multiple times for more people. So yeah, I mean, the thing here is that the fitment is good. As much as the client benefits, the talent also does. Content writing, this is a very, I think, this quintessential to the flexible talent space. So a startup in the space of sales trainings and assessments wanted a B2B content writer. So again, While you may know that content writing and writers are definitely available in the freelance economy or the flexible economy, what I also want to say is that even if you want domain fitment, so within the content writing space, if you want to hire somebody who has experience writing B2B content or B2C content, or health content, finance content, then or children's content, parenting content, there are so many today. Content is, what drives a lot of lead acquisition, it drives a lot of marketing, and you may want specialized writers, specialized, people for that. And a lot of that talent is also available. So, for example, in this case, we were able to find a B2B content writer and, to work for the 15 to 20 hours a month that they needed. And that person had, great experience writing for other businesses, and it's grateful. In fact, here also, if I remember right, the number of hours increased after the first month that she was working for them. And this is another content writing experience, but with a larger company. So, big company wanted a premium beauty writer as in the run up to their launch. They wanted somebody to come in, create very evocative sort of materials, for them. And we were able to give them that person. And I think what the reason I've put this example here is because it was interesting in the sense that we structured for them an arrangement where it was 40 hours spread out over 2 months that they took. But there was a launch, there was a delay in their launch in the middle of it. And we were able to actually hit pause and, restart the engagement after the launch was back on track. So a lot of different things can be done with the flexible, ecosystem. I mean, which are not possible with the traditional hiring model. A digital marketing example. Okay, this again is a very very unique example. So here, a startup in the edtech space. She wanted a digital team in house, and she had gone to agencies and somehow it had not worked out. So she wanted to hire the team in house. However, she didn't. I mean, many of us would know a digital team or a digital effort requires multiple skills. You require somebody who's in social media. You require an SEO. You require paid marketing, you require content. So there are multiple aspects to delivering, good digital marketing. And she did not have the ability to hire 4 different people full-time for all of these different skills. So, flexibility was the answer. She came to us with, maybe 2 to 3 hours or 4 to 5 hours per skill. So social media marketer working 10 to 15 hours a week, SEO specialist working, 10 to 15 hours a week. And once these two actually went in and were working for say a month or two, is when the paid marketing person also went in, and that person say was working for around 4 to 5 hours a day. That's 20 to 25 hours a week. So basically, she got her entire digital team, but it was in a very cost-effective manner because she was able to hire each person exactly for the time that she thought that she would need them, and not have to invest in hiring full-time people for all 3-4 of these different areas. So yeah, and we were able to find people who had exactly this expertise that that was needed. So social media marketing professional who had worked in the education space, SEO specialist who had 10 plus years of experience, a paid marketing manager who was an expert with AdWords and various other kinds of analytics and optimization. So it worked well. A technology example. So this is our tester example. Startup wanted to test their mobile app, a couple of months before the launch. They hired a tester for 60 hours spread out over 3 months. And that is the time they needed for the application to be tested before it could go live. And we were able to give them somebody who had 12 years of working experience in the IT industry, 7 of those in software testing. So yeah, that was good. Yeah, another example of technology is where we gave a data wrangler to an FMCG company in Singapore for their e-com business. And they wanted, what they did was they had a team for e-com data, but they cut out this part which required the data, which was the data wrangling expertise. And they outsourced that to us. And the person was working from India for them. So activities range from data cleaning, processing, uploading, etc. And we were able to give them somebody who had that experience, who had the right mix of experience as well. So yeah, for larger companies, one of the use cases is also to be able to identify parts of roles that they feel that can be outsourced and will be either which will either ease the burden on their existing team and also result in cost efficacy. That becomes a use case for them to hire talent flexibly. A finance example. So this is a startup, a PMS startup, and they needed an equity research analyst. We were able to give them somebody who had great experience in equity research analysis with one of the leading mutual funds in India. and was able to work for 4 to 5 hours a day and do all of the things, the research and you know, identify investment options for them and do financial modeling and all of that. And in fact, this, if I remember, this engagement went on for a couple of years. It was such a great fit mutually for both that it was it continued for really long. And another example of finance, but in a different space of finance, was when this software company, big one, needed an experienced insurance consultant. So they needed somebody to work again part time, 4 to 5 hours a day, to handle insurance renewals, claims, and this again was the same use case that I spoke of earlier. They wanted to relieve the existing in-house team of some of the additional bandwidth. So they hired a person to work part time for that, and we were able to give them a vetted insurance professional who had handled all of these things that they wanted. And then this is one of our biggest verticals apart from sales, learning and assessment. So with the proliferation of education technology startups, learning and assessment is really big right now. People want to create quality educational content for various target audiences. So this is actually one of my favorite examples, because this company, this education startup, it provides experiential science learning to kids. So they send out activity kits to children, which have experiments that they can do, and they can learn they can learn fundamentals of physics and chemistry in a very fun and also impactful manner. So very different from how we would have been taught science maybe at school. So this company needed authors who could write their activity guides, which goes along with those kits. We were able to give them 3 science writers with various experience. So one was a postdoctoral research associate and a PhD in the life sciences. Another was a senior research fellow, and a third was a dentist who also became a QMAT teacher. So a mix of experience is what we were able to give them. And this also worked out well. It was very satisfying that we were able to work with a startup which was doing such great work. So I think that's all the examples that I have. In fact, I am done with my presentation as well. So I would be happy to take on any questions right now.
Yeah, Shreya. So Shreya, we do have a few questions lined up.
Yeah.
Okay. So the first question is from Ashi. She is asking, do you have a clerical level candidates too? And also, will you have paramedical and medical related persons too?
What is the first part of the question? Clerical.
Yeah. Do you have clerical level?
Our pool in particular may have, by clerical level, she means admin, is it? Admin or administrative? Yeah, we would have administrative talent as well. Yes.
Okay. And other one was related to, do you have paramedical and medical related persons?
We have medical related people. We have people who, at different levels, from people who have worked in transcription to doctors, to content writers in the health space, erstwhile doctors who are doing that now. So we have, different levels of people in the medical fraternity. I'm not so sure by, what she means by paramedical though. So.
Okay.
In general, to give a sense, our pool is actually very experienced. So we have around 15,000 women in our pool at this point in time, pan-India. And with an average of 7 years of work experience, around 80% of them are post-grads. So it's an educated, experienced, qualified pool, having worked across industries and functions.
Okay. So another question is by Dave. He's asking, sales and marketing professionals are available and how it works?
So how does what work? How does the process work with us? Is that
that's the question.
Okay. So, it works very simply. So if you are a company that requires, say, a salesperson, so you can get in touch with any of us, or you can come to our website, check it out and fill a lead form. And somebody from my team, say a BD manager, will speak to you and understand, break down basically what you need. So if it is a salesperson you need, whether it is B2B, B2C, domain, who is the target audience, a lot of those things. We'll break it down and then we'll give you, say, a proposal in a couple of days, which will have some sample profiles and a pricing. And if you're okay with those things, is when we will go back and do the selection. So we, the other thing that we do as FlexiBees is we are not a marketplace. We do the selection in-house because we feel, we believe that it's important in the flexi space to gauge for multiple parameters to be able to make sure that the person we are giving, the candidate we are giving, has the right time availability in their lives, that they have the commitment, the work ethic. A lot of those things have to be gauged. So we do that selection ourselves and we give you the, you know, the bullseye, you know, 2 to 3 profiles per role that you can interview with. And if you like them, then we can very quickly do the contracting and the launch can happen within a day or two. That's how it works.
So another question is by Tarun Kohli. He is asking how many typically senior level earns per hour basis and pros and limitation of such work arrangement for client and person offering his services.
I didn't get that actually. How many? Can you just repeat the question?
Yes, senior level earns per hour basis. So if someone hire a senior level management, so what would be the cost for them and what is the pros and limitation of such work?
Okay, so what would be the cost? It's very dependent on what the role is and the level of seniority that the company needs. So for example, we have placed senior marketing talent at, you know, for part-time at, you know, maybe 1.5 to 2 lakhs per month. Even that we've done off. And we've of course also done, you know, marketing talent, which is at the level of say 40 to 50,000 or maybe even lower if it is in the assisting space or a junior person that you're talking about. So it completely depends on what the profile is and the level of experience. The way that we do the pricing is we take the role and what the role requires in terms of experience. We know what the market rate for that is and we do a pro rata as per the number of hours. So if the market rate is say 50,000 rupees per month and if you require them for 4 to 5 hours, then we will then the pricing will be 25,000, which is half of a full-time person's pricing. That's how we price it. But it's very dependent on what you need.
Okay. So another question is by Rab. He is asking, do you charge companies or deduct from candidate salary? And how much do you charge?
We charge companies. We definitely charge companies. And the biggest reason behind not charging candidates is because we want to retain the independence of being able to select from our pool. Without any conflict of interest, it's you know, so we want to make sure that we are doing a great job of the selection itself, so that clients at the end of the day get the best fit possible. So we charge the clients. I'll just give you a sense of how we do how our models, revenue models work. So one is a placement model, which if the client wants to take the person on their own roles, it could be flexible, part-time, remote, but they want that person on their own roles. In that case, we have a simple 1 month worth of salary. But the other model is the more, say, popular one, which is where the contracting is with us as FlexiBees. So you as client contract with us directly and we have a back-to-back contract with the talent. You pay us a pre-agreed amount every month. We retain a part of it and we pass on the remaining to the talent. This is the model that most people prefer. Most clients prefer because it saves them the hassle of having to manage payroll, having to keep the people on their own roles. And it also ensures that we are part of the process. We have skin in the game. So we are there in case anything comes up. We are there to handle it.
Yeah. So there is an interesting question by Dave. He is asking, how do you measure output of this talent?
So, yeah. So basically, see, a lot of the functions that we do are basically knowledge functions. So with the exception of sales and content, because in content also you can measure, say, number of pieces of content that have been written or designed. In sales, you can measure the, you know, the sales done or the number of meetings set up. But say marketing, investment banking, digital marketing, a lot of it is knowledge based. So it is not everything can be put in the form of say hard output and rate per output, because it would not be fair and do justice to the role. A marketing role where a person is supposed to think about your positioning, branding, and do the execution of your communication cannot be sort of, you know, whittled down to say a per hour rate. But what does happen is, and we leave this to the companies to discuss with the talent, and mutually they decide KPIs, things that you would track and measure, because those things are possible for every role. That is what gives the clients a sense of how the work is progressing. And secondly, we have a system of time trackers where we make available time sheets that the talent fills and that the client has access to. And so you know what is the approximate number of hours that have gone in every week by the candidate. So between these two things, which is setting the right KPIs transparently in mutual agreement with the talent and the time tracking mechanism, everybody gets a fair sense of where work is going and how and whether it is being done well.
So we do have a few questions lined up by Anand. The first one is asking, can the 2-week work?
Can the
2-week work peak be spread across 3 months for resource? So instead of 2-week work, can he divide in that 3 months the resource?
Yeah, absolutely. So 2-week work, I think full time for 2 weeks is 100 hours. Mm-hmm. That's the amount that you would work if you were in a full-time role. At least that's the stipulated amount. Yeah, absolutely. Depending on what the role is, you can split it across 3 months. So it would be, 30 to 40 hours per month. Yes, that can be done.
Yeah. Another question by him. It's, do you have a standard rate card or is it custom design?
It's standard at this point in time because we've done so many roles now that we exactly know the sweet spot. What is for this role, what is the rate that is likely to be okay for the client and the candidate both. So it's very standardized at this point in time.
Okay. And he's asking again, if we have issues with a particular resource, do you give a replacement for this resource?
Yeah, absolutely. Yes. A replacement free of cost. Yeah.
Achha, do you give a backup resource for every 5 resources provided by you, assuming all resources provided are in the same technology and domain space?
A backup resource? Yeah. No, we don't do that because, like I said, a lot of our roles are they're mid to high end roles. So and many times they have complexities within. So for example, if some of the examples I gave, if you want somebody in marketing, you may want that person to have a particular domain experience. You may want them to have a number of years of experience. You may want them to have some channel expertise, say digital or offline. So a combination of these skills is not very easy to find. So we are able to find maybe 2 to 3 good people. And then on top of that, there is a personality fitment that needs to also, happen. So at the end of the day, you may like that one person very much. And, it's not so easy to find a backup for that one person and keep them in the pipeline, because it's like any other full-time talent hiring. When you're hiring somebody full-time, you're hiring that whole person. It's not a very, if you're not hiring somebody, say, for data entry, etc., because, that is a fungible skill. A marketing or a sales may not be. So what we do is we have an empanelment at our end where we have the next best person in line already. So if there is a problem that comes, we replace the person very quickly. We are able to replace that person, may be slightly different from your original person, but will be able to carry out the work equally well. I hope that answers.
Yeah. And another question is actually, it's a personal question by Right Pillar. He is asking, you have given the right example of investment banking firm requiring people for making financial model and pitch deck. So he wants to schedule a call with you. So are you okay with it?
Yeah, sure. So, you can write to me at shreya@flexibees.com and we can take it ahead from there.
And there's another guy who want to again, register our expertise and talent with Flexibees. So, it's like one-on-one with you. What I would suggest, you could share your email ID in the chat box and, people can, write to you and then you can line up the meetings.
Sure. Yeah, I'll do that.
Okay, there is another question by Surendra referring to the case study of digital marketing project for AdTech. How different is the offering compared to, say, working with an outsourced services company like a digital marketing agency? Would it be cost or other benefits too?
I think other benefits, which is why so it could be cost. You can hear me, right?
Yeah, it's audible.
So, see, agencies also come across a wide range, right? You could have agencies which are very, very, very cost-effective. You could have agencies which are expensive. So, it could be cost, which is a benefit compared to the more expensive ones. But I think the reason people would come to us, say, for kitting out a digital team for themselves in-house rather than going for an agency is that they would have more control. I think that is what. So, they may have, in this particular case, they, I think, went to an agency and they did not enjoy the experience. They probably did not feel that their account was given enough importance or time by the agency. So they wanted a little more control, a little more say in how things were doing. They may have wanted, say, more agility also. You can just pick up the phone and speak to your in-house team. And, with an agency, you may have to go through one or two layers. So I think that those are the benefits that you may get by hiring people in-house rather than going with an agency.
So there is a question by Dave. He's asking how FlexiBase is different from other consultancy.
Other consultancies? You mean other talent companies?
Yeah.
So in terms of recruitment firms, we are very different because recruitment firms by and large don't even provide flexible talent. So they provide full-time talent largely. And we of course have the flexible, we are able to provide flexible talent, which is part-time, remote, short-duration contracts. So that entire range of services is not what a recruitment firm would provide. And in terms of how we do it, again, I would say we are different because a recruitment firm, as far as I have seen, will do maybe one or two levels of basic screening to see fitment, and they will send you a host of resumes after that. Whereas our selection process, like I said, is very detailed. We do a very detailed multi-touchpoint selection process to ensure that the person is the right fitment in terms of skills, but also in terms of their time availability, their commitment, work ethic, a lot of those things.
Yeah. So this question by Tarun is asking, services offering by your company, so that talent basically act as freelancer consultant or as your employees?
So they are not definitely our employees for sure. They work directly with the client. So it's as good as a relationship that the client would have with an in-house employee. I mean, work is completely between the client and the talent. Only the contract is with us in most cases. In the model that most people prefer, the contracting is via us. That's the only way in which we are involved. And as part of that, we do one or two things. For example, the time tracking process, like I said, that is something that we facilitate. Invoicing process, of course, we facilitate. If any interventions are needed, then we get into the picture. And of course, if a replacement is needed, then also we are the ones who take care of that. So apart from that, the working relationship is entirely between the client and the talent.
So another question is, if we are paid once, then how much is the time limit we can use the resource?
So all of these things are hashed out before even the arrangement is contracted for. So you could come and say that I need this person for 3 months. So you could say I need this person for 2 weeks. So you could say I need this person for 100 hours spread out over the next two to three months. So it could depend on you. It is actually entirely dependent on your need, and we will make sure that the same is communicated to the candidate as well, and that the contracting also reflects that. So it's very transparent.
Great. So Anand is asking, can you share your standard rate card and coordinates with all the participants?
Again, the rate card is very dependent on what is the role that you're coming with. So internally, we have the rate card, but we usually don't share it because, it's dependent on what kind of role you want. So for example, marketing or digital marketing could have various sub roles under it. So it doesn't make sense to say share maybe, 10, 20 sub roles under, say, one big role with everyone. But if you come to us and we slot your requirement as one of those sub roles, we will give you a rate which is as per that rate card.
So there is an interesting question by Shilpa. Do you assure data security from the candidates?
That is an interesting question because data security is a very tricky thing. So we don't ensure it. We can facilitate it in the form of, say, NDAs. If you want the candidate to sign an NDA for you, then that can be done. If you want any sort of non-competence or you want to put a clause of exclusive working, some of those things can be done. But yeah, data privacy can be a very tricky and very vast topic. So I'm not sure today anybody can really ensure it. And that too, I mean, even for your in-house employees, in fact, the data privacy environment is going to see a vast change once the India data privacy bill comes into play. So it the enforcement of it is an entirely different matter. We can facilitate whatever it is that you as a company set out for yourself as your data, data policy. Yeah.
Okay. So another question is by Praveen. He's asking, can you provide frontline sales guy on contractual basis for the year?
Yeah. I mean, it could be for as long as you want it. Yeah, definitely. By frontline, if you mean somebody who's going to be a field salesperson and constantly be on the field, then that may be difficult for us because a lot of our talent is, wants some element of flexibility, so wants some element of remote. So we have done sales roles where there is client meetings, but largely B2B. So what B2B client meetings means is that they are able to control it to some extent. They are able to set their appointments. They are able to do pipeline building remotely. And they don't have to be on the field every day going door to door, etc. So door to door sales or a very high travel oriented field sales may be difficult for our pool. The duration of the engagement a year or whatever is not a problem that we can do.
Okay. So there's another question. How much would it cost for a marketing person part time?
Again, I mean, depends on what the role is. So it, are you talking about digital marketing or are you talking about core marketing? What are the number of hours that you're looking at? Or is it a marketing assistant you're talking about? Or are you talking about sales? So it could depend on what really the role is that you're looking at. I mean, I can talk to you separately and understand.
Right. So the other question by Tarun is asking, in next 2 years, how much percentage of hiring is expected to shift to your model versus regular employment at an entry, mid, senior level?
What percentage? Now that is difficult to pin down, but I would say, from what we are seeing has happened after Corona, we are still in the pandemic, but after some of the unlocks have happened, we have seen a lot of new business coming our way from people who earlier would not have wanted to hire talent remotely. We've seen those kinds of people coming our way. We've also seen clients coming for contractual positions which earlier they would have hired in-house for. And this is startups and this is also larger companies. A lot of large companies today want to go the contractual hiring route, which is because of cost pressures, etc. And so we're seeing a lot of new business and new clients coming in. Where the percentage ultimately lands depends on a lot of things. It depends on how long the pandemic lasts, how long it takes for the economy to revive. But no matter which way, we think that the adoption of contractual remote part-time models is going to be it's going to really speed up in the next couple of years.
So Anand is asking, can they pay resource combination of fixed and variable?
Yeah, absolutely. So our sales, in fact, is built on that philosophy only. So there is a fixed component and there's a variable component. The fixed component mostly flows via us and as in contracted via us. The variable component is between you and the talent. You can pay them as per the achievement.
Okay. And the question is by Danish. He's asking, how good fitment for a BPO industry?
For the BPO industry. Yeah. I would say that, the fitment isn't great from my experience of having spoken with a couple of clients or done a couple of engagements with the BPO industry. And that's because the BPO industry typically doesn't have any flexibility. So, typically as a BPO resource, you are supposed to sit at a desk and take call after call after call after call. And, there are very scheduled and structured breaks. And for our talent pool, that doesn't work very well because our talent pool is looking for flexibility in their lives. They want to, so for example, sales is a very, very good fit for us. We have a huge number of sales. Sales is our biggest vertical, by the way. We have around 20 to 30% of our work, talent pool is also sales professionals, women who were at very good positions in sales and then took a break and now want to return, but they want to return with flexibility. Sales is a great fit because they can decide when they want to call. So while they'll be working for 4 to 5 hours in the day, they can decide which 4 to 5 hours. Of course, all of those will be within office hours, but there is flexibility to work for, say, a couple of hours in the morning, then take an hour long break, then work for a couple of hours in the afternoon, some of that, right? But with the BPO industry, that's not an option because call volumes are so high, you're supposed to really sit there and answer call after call, which doesn't give our talent pool the flexibility. So I would say not such a great fit. KPO, yes. BPO, maybe not.
Another question is by Dave. He is asking the case study you shared about the digital marketing and SEO, secondly, pre-sales guy, is the same what is going to be the cost?
Did I mention cost? I don't think I did. Or does he want to know the cost?
Yeah. He is asking whether it's the same, what is going to be the cost?
What is going to be the cost? So I'll tell you for sales, for an inside sales role where the person is supposed to do a meeting setup, this is not really pre-sales, but this is meeting setup. So for example, if you want somebody to, speak to CXOs, do the concept selling to them and show them the demo and set up a meeting for your on-field team to then take ahead. So that's the meeting setup role, which is very, very popular. For that, for a part-time resource, we charge anywhere between 20 to 24K. And that's the fixed component. And that includes the FlexiVis fee also. So that is, that should give you a benchmark of what our sales pricing is. Okay.
So there is another question. Any example how you shortlist experienced candidate for project-based work?
How we do the shortlisting? So we have a multi-touch point process, which is made up of many different interviews and engagements to ensure that we are getting a good sense of their skills as well as other aspects of their working style and whether they have the time or not. So yeah, it's a combination of a lot of these things. It's an entire process that's with multiple steps to it. That's probably the easiest to give as an answer instead of going into a lot more detail.
Yeah, another question by Rajesh is asking, is your talent restricted to registering from women pool entry only?
Yes. At the moment, yes. And for the foreseeable future, yes. Because this is a very big problem for the women pool where they are very qualified, but they do not or cannot work for the traditional workforce full time. And they want a more flexible option. So we want to especially make these kinds of options available to the women pool.
This is another question by Shilpa. Can I spread hours of working over longer period, pay per hour, over 2 to 3 months?
Yeah, you can. The only constraint over here will be if the if the per hour rate is and the number of hours is so low that it doesn't make sense for any of us from a fixed cost perspective, the cost that we are likely to incur in doing the selection. But if it is a decent number of hours or the hourly rate is decent enough, you can structure it any which way you like.
So there's another question. Minimum duration lock-in contract period is for how much time? Say for 2 weeks or 1 month?
There is no lock-in. First of all, I mean, any contracting has an exit. So first see that. But we are typically for our roles, which are, where you want an ongoing resource, we start with a 3 month contract and that gets renewed upon mutual agreement. If it is a project, it could be anything. It could start with 40 hours. It could start with 2 to 3 weeks. Depends on the need of the project. Okay. Even for the role, if you need it for less, if you want to do it for 2 months or something, then we can even do those things.
There is another question by Sandeep. He's asking, which all cities you have the manpower for sales?
Across India. So we have a pan-India pool. The tilt is towards the metros and the tier one cities. but it's present across the country.
So Shilpa is asking, what is your definition of decent number of hours?
It's a difficult thing to say because it's a combination with the hourly rate, right? So if the hourly rate is very high, for example, then even 10 hours per month can be done, correct? I mean, it depends on what the hourly rate is. If the hourly rate is low, then, you know, maybe even 20 hours or 25 hours may not be enough for us to get some fixed, our fixed or selection cost out of it. But, usually we end up starting maybe 20 hours, 20 to 25 hours kind of roles as well. And even for content graphics, if the requirement is for say two blogs or one newsletter or something like that, those also we end up doing. We do them. So I would suggest that you can maybe write to us if you have a requirement and we can figure out how to do it.
Okay. We'll take this last question, which is about: are you offering services in Delhi? Is agreement tri-party agreement or only between client and person offering services? Person offering services and your company, he means.
Okay, so I'll first part I didn't get. The second part, yes, it's not a tripartite agreement, but it is. There are two sort of agreements in place. So there is one agreement that's between the client and Flexibees. Again, this is the most oft chosen model, where the client contracts with us, and then we have a back-to-back mirroring contract with the talent. So there are two agreements in play over here. The first question was what, something about Delhi?
Yeah, so he is asking, are you offering services in Delhi?
Yeah, absolutely. Delhi is one of our big markets because we are present wherever startups are. So Delhi is, of course, the NCR is a good startup hub. So yeah, we definitely offer services there.
Okay. Another question, of course, it says, how do you secure payment of persons offering services?
How do we secure? So how do we make sure we are being able to pay
the
person who's working with us? That actually means, how do we make sure that the client pays us? Is that what the question really becomes? Because once the client pays us, we will definitely pay the consultant. There is no question of why we would not pay. So then if the question is, how do we ensure the client pays us? To be honest, we haven't had too many problems so far. I mean, the startup ecosystem, predominantly our clients are startups, 90% of them. They have been very above board in most cases. We have got payments from, we haven't had to chase too much. Sometimes a bit of delay happens. But how we ensure it from our side is we make sure the contracts are tight, airtight. The other thing is that the need is strong. I think our clients know that, they really like the talent and they want to continue working with the talent, and that can only happen if they continue to pay us, right? So that's one way make sure that the payments are coming, that the talent is actually good. And the third is that clients come to us for a lot of repeat. So around 65% of our business comes from repeat clients. So when businesses know that you have to go back to this, these people for other roles also, then you would definitely treat them well and pay them for what you are taking from them today. So all these things ensure we get paid by the client. Once we get paid by the client, we of course pay the consultant also.
So thank you, Shreya. It was a quite interesting and interactive session, I could say, because lots of questions were answered by you. And it was like one-on-one question, I could say. And hope, guys, we have covered most of your questions. And Shreya, could you share any contact details,
I'll share my email ID. It's I've put it in the chat window. Shreya@flexibees.com.
Okay. And any contact number do you have? Because most of the people are keen to have your service, I could see.
Sure. I mean, people can reach me at 99301-43407. I would prefer if people message because, that's easier to manage.
Should I share your number in the chat box?
Yes. And I've also put my email ID there. So.
Sure. So friends, you can pick up the contact number and email ID. And as she suggested, okay, please WhatsApp her before calling up. Yeah. Thanks, Shreya. Good session.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye. Bye, guys.
Bye-bye.